Valentine announced that a gentleman by the name of, the gentleman's name is Jim Daughter, who served on Flat Top Mountain Lookout near Mount St. Helens, in 1959 announced that he had seen a red and white spinning discs, perhaps 1,000 feet across, travel the distance from Mount Hood to Mount Adams in 40 seconds, one of two enclosed encounters he had that summer. His wife Martha, attending the banquet with him, said she also had seen the huge silent object, and quote, it looked like a mercury vapor lamp. She said, I thought I could see the windows. When Ron Johnson, director of the Oregon chapter of the Forest Fire Lookout Association, asked who in the room had seen similar things while on lookout duty, a dozen hands went up. The sighting seems to be concentrated in the Cascade Range. For those of you out there across the river in Washington, please let us know if you know of any encounters of forestry individuals who have seen this. Also, like I said, our telephone number is 667-7434. If you'd like to write to the Cosmic Connection, it's Post Office Box 86186, Portland, Oregon, 97286. If you send me a self-addressed stamped envelope, like this one right here, a big envelope with enough stamps on it that you think would get your package back to you, we'd be more than happy to send you information that you may be interested in. The mail, ladies and gentlemen, we just received all this mail quite a bit. For the last 2 or 3 weeks, I'm answering it right now, ladies and gentlemen. We have an individual who ordered the UFO 101 tapes and booklets, HR. Your packages are in the mail. They will be sent to you, and I'm sure you're going to enjoy those videos and the accompanying packet information booklets, UFO, the Area 51 tabloid here that we have, and Aliens Over Oregon, HR. You're going to enjoy that. Mr. Lasky, sir, thank you very much. I want to thank you very much for sending me this information. He sends me these about every 2 weeks. It's from the Echo FidoNet, one of these computer bulletin boards. Just tons of information. We have some information here dealing with the Shoemaker Levy 9 impact with Jupiter, the planetary spacecraft, as observers. Three NASA spacecraft missions launched some years ago to explore various planets and the Sun will observe the events surrounding the Shoemaker Levy 9 impacts with Jupiter from a unique perspective. These random collisions that will be taking place the week of July 16th through the 22nd will be spectacular. The coverage will include a series NASA will provide impact of the comet P and Shoemaker Levy 9 during a week of July 16th and the 22nd. It will be televised press briefings, a 24-hour newsroom operation at the Goddard Space Flight Center, Greenbelt, Maryland. The first fragment of the comet will impact Jupiter just before 4 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. On July 16th, on the side of Jupiter facing away from the Earth, starting at 10 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, NASA will release the image in a live program broadcast from the Space Telescope Science Institute, Baltimore, Maryland, also. Okay, I understand we have a phone call. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a guest. We'll be on here for shortly. She's going to tell us about, she's a representative and the founder of the Oasis Center. Hello, Susan.
Yes, hello.
Hi. Hello, Susan. Welcome to the Cosmic Connection.
Yes, Cosmo.
Could you turn up your speaker there just a little bit? Susan, we have your UFO crop circles. What's that, facts or fake?
Fact or fake, right.
All right. Would you tell us a little bit about the Oasis Center, please?
Okay, well, I founded the Oasis Center about a year and a half ago, and it's an alternative healing center in Tigard, Oregon, and it was created to exist as a safe and loving haven for those who desire to improve their quality of life. And we provide a wide variety of exciting, fun, and enlightening activities here that take place all through the month. And we do all kinds, you know, we have alternative healing that go on here. We have classes and workshops that take place. I show videos on the earth changes to help people understand what's going on in the earth and why these things are occurring and where they're taking us to. We do classes in yoga and meditation, Tai Chi. We do drumming circles. We offer all kinds of things here. We have a really, really great time here.
Well, that's fantastic, Susan. Now, the lady that will be speaking at your event this coming Friday and Saturday?
Yes, we're having a special event this Friday and Saturday. Both evenings will begin at 7:30, and people can come to either evening, for they will be the same presentation. But we're bringing a woman named Eilis, who is the national coordinator for the Center for Crop Circle Studies here in the United States. Eilis has been studying crop circles all over the world for several years now, and she's part of a research team that travels around and studies them. And so when one appeared here in Aloha, Oregon, naturally Eilis was here, and I heard about her and contacted her and asked her if she would be willing to come to the Oasis and do an event, because I'm very interested in people being informed. This is not something that is made by drunken high school kids out looking for a good time. This is a real, live phenomena that has taken place in our backyard. And I'm very interested in being part of the resources to provide people with an understanding of that.
She will be discussing the crop circles. Will she be saying anything about this recent crop circle that's been found in our backyard here?
Most definitely. Like I said, she has studied many, and she's from Port Angeles, Washington. She's not that far from the Kennewick one that appeared last year. And she came down and spent a whole day dowsing and studying the circle that's in Aloha, Oregon. She says, without a doubt, this is an authentic circle. In fact, she said the energy coming from the circle was some of the most intense that she had ever experienced in any of the circles. This isn't a real live phenomena.
Well, I've got an article here written by Jerry F. Boone of the Oregonian staff saying there's a lot of evidence to support the teens and beer theory, celebrating their high school graduation and whatnot. I've talked to Channel 6. They say that there are divots pounded in the center of the circle, and that's why I haven't really jumped on this. True, I have not gone out there and investigated it myself, but I really wouldn't know what to look for.
Well, I
would look at it. So I think it's as Dennis would say, this is up in the air in the gray basket right now.
Okay, this first of all, it couldn't have been made by teenagers drinking, because the circles are perfect in formation, and all of the circles that appear have some kind of symbology to it, some kind of ancient symbology. But when you go into the circle, of course, now it's all been trampled, but
sure.
When you look at the wheat, and not one piece of wheat is bent or is broken, it's just bent.
Right.
It's not something that could be made by a human.
Well, one of our Cosmic Connection investigators and callers to the program have taken some samples of the vegetation and sent it to Linda Moulton Howell, who will be sent to an individual, and it will be looked at for molecular DNA changes and whatnot to the circles. Again, you will be at this speaking thing. I understand you have other activities through the year. We want to get the connection out and make the announcement of the Oasis Center, and hopefully all things will go well for you. This I know it's a little soon or a little late to be broadcasting this, but maybe the people who are watching this program now in the repeats of the program will stop by out there and say hello.
Yeah, so what we're doing here is we're encouraging people to come out and get the facts on the crop circle to find out how the phenomena happens, what it's about. There's a much deeper meaning to it, and there's a message that those circles are giving us that we're picking up in our bodies and our subconscious minds. And it would be very enlightening if people would come out and see what it's really about, because they're all being affected by it. Everybody in this area is being affected by that circle.
Well, how so?
Because the circle makers have a message that's put into the circle, and it goes out, and our bodies are reading the message like sheet music. And so we are all being affected. And when you actually go in and sit in the circle, you are actually, your DNA structure is being altered. And scientists have studied these circles around the world, and what they are discovering, in fact, is that the cellular molecular structure within the circle is significantly different than outside of the circle. And so this, I mean, there's a much...
We've already found this out, is that correct?
Oh, yes, that's already been proven.
Well,
so there's a much, much bigger picture here than what people are led to believe. And so we just really want to encourage people to come out here on Friday, Saturday evening at 7:30.
All right, would you give your phone number, please?
Yes.
We have it here. Just go ahead and give that out again.
Yes, my phone number here in Tigard. I'm right outside of Portland. I'm not very far from downtown Portland. My phone number here is 245-5685. Once again, that's 245-5685, and we welcome...
And the area code's 503.
Area code is 503, correct.
Okay. There will be an emission. We cannot... Go ahead and announce that, but if you're interested in viewing this happening, call that number. And Susan, I want to thank you very much for being a guest and calling in on this program.
And thank you, Cosmo, for allowing me this time.
We're more than happy. This is what the program's all about. Thank you, Susan.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay, very good. Ladies and gentlemen, you don't hear Dennis. Dennis is not in the auditorium. Dennis, I believe, is on assignment somewhere. He will be back in future shows, no doubt. I also have an in-house guest taking care of his duties, if it warrants. Miles, are you online there, pal?
I believe so.
All right. Mr. Director, is Miles coming through? Is that right? Okay, very good. All right, Miles, let's take a call, huh? Welcome to the Cosmic Connection. Hello, you're next on the Cosmic Connection.
Hello, Cosmic. This is Jay.
There you are, Jay.
Hey, we're really lucky to have Miss Carol Peterson in this in Portland. She really knows her stuff about crop circles.
Yes, we certainly are.
Now listen, July 31st is when the Showtime special is going to show the long-awaited Roswell. This is with Kyle MacLachlan and Martin Sheen.
And right, that's right. I believe we've got a shot of it, camera four. If camera four could shoot down here along the bottom, we have the UFO crash at Roswell. Go ahead, Jay.
Neil Hardcopy in May showed a UFO.
We have a shot of camera four here on the Roswell photos, on the black and white photos.
You know, the sensational show Hardcopy showed a UFO fly over Roswell this March of this year.
I believe I did see that. That's the Esco...
Right. Jose Escamilla.
Very good. Thank you.
So
That was a great video. And I believe we've got some of that on our background today. People will be looking around at that. Go ahead, Jay.
Continuing on, by the way, a triangle UFO has been seen by hundreds of people in Japan.
Is that right?
Now, this is the same shape, that is, that has been shown over Belgium and France and other countries. So this is a hot topic. In fact, it's been making the national news in Japan, something that does not happen in our country. Except on shows like Cosmic Connection.
Absolutely, Jay. Jay, what can you tell us about Shoemaker Levy 9?
At 12 o'clock, our time, on Saturday, hold on, in case it hits the wrong planet.
Okay.
I'm just kidding. But I'll tell you what, they've got about 20 of them will be hitting every 2 or 3 hours, beginning at approximately 12 o'clock on Saturday. Now, Richard Hoagland speculates each one will hit with a force of about 1 billion megatons, which is significant.
World War III, huh?
Well, if it hit our planet, it would be lights out.
Absolutely.
Now, in Pennsylvania recently, a researcher was able to obtain 668 documents from the State Department. They talk about Project Moondust. Now, if you remember,
I like Moondust.
Project Moondust is the alleged code name of a crash retrieval operation to recover landed space debris. Now, this is significant. In 1965, a very similar to Roswell, in Kecksburg, Pennsylvania, we had another crash and retrieval in 1965 in Kecksburg. And now this researcher has discovered from the State Department releases a reference, or many references, to Project Moondust. So this is extremely significant, because how long will our government deny it? From sightings to their own documents, to TV shows and sightings in Japan, to the Showtime special on July 31st, to the Cosmic Connection and Carol Peterson.
Well, I've been listening to the tapes of Richard C. Hoagland on the last Art Bell's Dreamland. People, you've sent me phone numbers and I've contacted you. Ladies and gentlemen, you have got to be in tune with Art Bell on Dreamland. That's every Sunday. Isn't that right, Jay?
Every Sunday night. It's worth listening to.
It's at 7 p.m. to 10. It's 3 hours on 1190 KEX Radio.
Now, if you miss his shows, he will give you a number where you could call and get shows that you've missed, which also applies to Don Ecker of UFO Tonight.
Absolutely.
Both good shows. They usually have similar guests, similar to your show. And, of course, if you miss your show also comes on at various times, too. Am
Absolutely.
I right, Cosmic?
Absolutely.
Okay, well, I thank you for your time, and continue on.
Jay, another fantastic report. We didn't get to the structures on the moon, but I'm sure someone else will.
Well, you better believe they will.
There's just not enough time in this hour,
not
sir.
Not enough time.
Thank you very much, Jay. Next caller, please. Welcome to the Cosmic Connection, live, Tuesday, 7 p.m., Channel 11, 667-7434. Let's hear from you across the river. Hello, welcome.
Yeah, hi, Cosmo. This is Frank Booth calling.
Hi, Frank.
I met you at the Randall and Schmidt conference at the Red Lion Hotel.
Yes, I do remember. How'd you like that?
Oh, it was the best UFO presentation I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, Michael Lindemann was outstanding. He was the follow-up speaker to Don Schmidt and Kevin Randall, who gave their seminar on the truth about the UFO crash at Roswell. Any comments, sir?
Well, I just thought it was very enlightening. As we discussed at the conference, I'm kind of or at least I was a UFO skeptic, and from all the evidence that they showed and everything, I really, at this point, I really think that there's a lot of validity to the whole UFO phenomenon.
Well, there is, the cover-up begins with certain aircraft that we've been test flying out at Area 51 in the last 25, 30 years. He brought up the connection with some spacecraft that people might think were UFOs, could be conventional aircraft that we are not aware of.
Right, right. And they really went through all the, because like I said, I'm really a skeptic, and he really went through all the information that I had in my mind, saying, well, you know, could it really be a weather balloon and things
sure.
of that nature. And it was very thorough. It was excellent. It was well worth the money that I paid to get in. And I was very impressed. I was wondering, though, if you could possibly put up your P.O. box so I could get an idea of how I can get a hold of you. I know it goes on. There it is. Okay, great. Well, I sure appreciate that.
That's our one-year anniversary, Frank.
Well, it's a great show. I'm sorry to see you changed from your weekend slot. I thought that was a great program, but, you know, I hope there are a lot of people that, like me, really enjoy the program and call in.
Well, thank you very much, Frank.
You, Cosmo.
Thank you very much, Frank. Great report. Like Frank was talking about, you can send us a self-addressed stamped envelope, or if you're interested, like there's so many people here who've written us cards and letters about getting our videotapes and our packages, UFO 101 and UFO 102, which is an advanced package dealing with some of the more astounding information dealing with the UFO phenomenon. UFO 101 deals with the Mexico City sightings, some Bob Lazar stuff, and a video that was shot in Las Vegas known as Sam's Town. Plus, you get Aliens Over Oregon. This is a pamphlet dealing with the 2 weeks in 1947 here in Oregon of sightings beginning and around the Kenneth Arnold sighting in the Cascade Mountains, with various newspaper clippings. And at the end, if they can't read some of the clippings, Dennis has been kind enough to type out, as he's gone, he must have gone through some of these articles with the magnifying glass to get all the words. Outstanding job there. Let's see, what are we going to do here? We'll take another call. Welcome to the Cosmic Connection.
How you doing, Cosmo?
Hi. Who's this?
This is Matt.
Matt?
Yeah.
We've been waiting for you, my friend.
Yeah.
What's online, Matt?
Well, I was wondering exactly what time, if you knew, the movie about the Roswell crash would be on Showtime on July 31st.
Right. Jay, if you want to call back and give us that time, we'll let Jay call back and give us that time. He could call back, talk to one of my producers, and the producer will run in here. We'll get that down. The Showtime Roswell crash time.
Right, right. Also, Linda Moulton Howe on Dreamland this past week explained that the samples that Dr. Livingood in Michigan received from Oregon was indeed anomalous. And,
very good.
You know, the crop circle in Aloha, there was...
Actually, we have some proof now. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, so there's no more speculation. We can get off the teens and beer party.
Right.
So
yeah,
to speak.
You know, what the local media reported was that, you know, people saw individuals in there stomping the grass or the wheat, but we know now that's not true. I mean, for what the anomalies were in the molecular structure of the wheat was not could not be reproduced by, you know, people stomping on the wheat.
Sure.
So,
go ahead, Matt.
No, that's all.
Hold on, hold on, pal. How about what were your opinions of the seminar of Mr. Lindemann, Mr. Schmidt, Mr. Randall?
Well, for whoever missed it, they missed a good presentation.
Sure.
Kevin Randall and Don Schmidt had live interviews with some of the witnesses there, and the witnesses who gave firsthand accounts of, you know, what happened at Roswell were more than convincing, you know, with the presentation and their accounts for what happened, and it at least displayed to me that these people weren't lying, and some of the critics who discount the firsthand eyewitness presentations because they haven't heard the accounts firsthand were pretty much wrong.
Well, there you go. That was, ladies and gentlemen, that was Don Schmidt and Kevin Randall. You saw there on your screen. That was part of the interview that I shot that Friday before we came on the air. They were kind enough to run an interview. We ran part of that interview, and we will show the entire interview on a later Cosmic Connection. Matt, while I have you here, I have some information that you made me aware of. This note is a message from a participant of Contact Echo discussing the types of aliens and their descriptions. Below, please find a copy of A Variety of Alien Beings. And here is the disclaimer. I make no claims for the accuracy of this list and express no personal opinion on the matter. It was given to me as an accurate information, and I just wanted to pass it along to anyone who might find it interesting or otherwise useful. I'd appreciate any feedback you'd care to share with me if you wish to proceed in this civilized manner. This is by David House. And Matt, this is about alien type 2, the reptilians.
Right.
The genetics akin to reptiles. These are highly advanced entities, but viewed as being of a negative, hostile, or dangerous disposition, since they regard humans as a totally inferior race. They would perceive us much as the way we would perceive a herd of cattle. They are carnivorous in regard to humans. There is supposedly a driven planetoid or asteroid inhibited by 30 million of these lizard folk that is to enter our solar system in the mid-1990s, if the present schedule is kept. They consider Earth to be their own ancient outpost and will expect to have complete control of the entire planet upon their return. Their own planet is becoming unable to adequately support life, and they need somewhere else to live. These are the aliens who are served by the Type A Greys. What's this all about, Matt?
Well, that came over the UFO Echo on Fidonet some years ago, about 3 years ago. And as best I can establish, there's no real origin for that outside of maybe the National Enquirer, okay?
Sure.
But one has to consider that the fact that the space probe Clementine, okay, was sent by the BMDO, the Ballistic Missile Defense Office, okay,
sure,
to photograph Geographos, which is an Earth-crossing asteroid the size of Manhattan, okay?
Wow.
The thing about that is that Geographos, the asteroid, has some pretty unusual properties as far as its luminosity. And if the BMDO, the Ballistic Defense, whatever, you know, okay, if they were producing satellites to track incoming Russian missiles, one has to consider why they would send a satellite to go track a giant rock versus, you know, something closest to Earth. Okay, this rock is going to be millions of miles away, okay?
Sure.
And the BMDO is sending this satellite to go photograph it millions of miles away. I mean, that's no way to test a satellite. I mean,
okay.
Or something to track, you know, metallic incoming objects to the United States from Russia. And that's pretty odd. And the odder thing is, like the Mars probe, okay, they somehow mysteriously, the space probe Clementine, which is the one that was
to
photograph it, disappeared. You know?
Matt, we're going to take another call. I've just been informed.
Okay.
Okay. Matt? Thank you, Matt.
You're welcome.
I appreciate it, my friend.
Bye-bye.
All right, next caller, please. I understand we have full lines. Hang on, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to get to you. Hi, welcome to the Cosmic Connection.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes, have you heard much about a Hangar 18?
What's your name?
Excuse me?
Just your name?
Bill.
And where are you calling from, Bill?
Portland.
Thank you. Hangar 18, well, there was a movie made about it. It's allegedly Hangar 18 is at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, or Wright-Patterson Air Materials Command in Dayton, Ohio. This is a place where the United States government, when capturing Russian planes during wars or any kind of foreign military type equipment, it's taken to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. It is dissected, taken photographs of each bolt, nut and bolt is meticulously looked at, photographed, and then put back together, and then we put it in storage or give it back to the rightful country if it so warrants. I understand that material from the Roswell crash, the Kingman crash, and various other retrievals have been sent to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, Ohio. What can you tell? Oh, and supposedly there are bodies out there in a frozen state, alien beings.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask, if you knew anything about those.
Supposedly in the early 70s, In Search of, the television show hosted by Leonard Nimoy, did a program on it, and supposedly in search of cameras, were allowed to go inside the base, but, you know, we don't know what kind of a sanitizing project that happened before they were allowed in there.
Yeah. All right, well, that was my... Oh, I've got one more question,
sure,
too.
Sure,
Bill. Has there ever been a lot of UFO activity out in Oregon? I just moved out here from Phoenix.
Absolutely. In fact, there's quite a bit. This program is going to try and deal with that. We have a gentleman by the name of Paul who lives out in Canby who gave a recent... I found his number. He left me a message. And this is out in Canby. I have it right here. This was October 23rd, 1992. Paul, age 19, saw an object the size of a helicopter. I've been informed that there is a helicopter company out there called there's just a helicopter company out there. These folks were sitting in a hot tub around 12 to 1 a.m. The color was white, flower petals type design. They were looking towards Salem. South Karras Road, looking south towards Salem, Highway 99 toward Hubbard. A tree line, between the tree line and them was this object. It was in the in the boundaries of 3 to 4 miles to this tree line. There was a boom and a flash, and Paul has talked to me about this. This was a sighting, like I said, 10-23-92. There have been sightings down in Hubbard. There have been sightings in Bend. We have sightings up in Yakima, Washington, through the forest in 1959. The sighting that really started off was with Kenneth Arnold back in 1947, June 6, 1947, in the Cascade Mountains. A private pilot, while looking for a downed transport, noticed 9 heel-shaped objects flying off, and he saw the glint, and that was where the term flying saucer came from, because he accounted it to saucers skipping across the water, Bill.
All right. Well, thank you very much for letting me be on your show, and
excuse me?
Thanks for letting me be on your show.
Welcome, Bill. Give us a call anytime and write to us. Thank you very much, Bill. Next caller, please. I understand we have a follow-up. Go ahead.
Howdy. Yeah. My name's John. And,
hi, John.
Look,
and you're calling from where?
From Portland. From Portland, Oregon.
Okay,
well, as far as UFOs, I'm like from Montana. You have to show me.
You're going to have to speak up, sir.
Well, as far as UFOs go.
Sure.
I'm like from Montana. You have to show me. And so when I was 13 years old, I saw.
You're how old?
Now? Oh, I'm 48.
Okay.
So when I was 13, this would be in 1958, I did see a UFO, me and my stepbrother, between Melton Freewater and Walla Walla, Washington. And I never thought too much about it, you know, didn't tell anybody. We just looked at each other and went, wonder what that was. Well, I moved to Portland, and I ran into a friend of mine now. He's a good friend. And this Wright-Patterson thing and Hangar 18 thing that this guy was talking about on just before, well, this friend of mine's father is a mathematician. And the government, when he was pretty young, like 3 or 4 years old, the government pulled his dad into a big Air Force base in the Midwest, maybe Wright-Patterson. He said that his father and him went to a hangar. And inside the hangar was a spacecraft with a roped off with guards around it. This kid, he's a little kid, and his father's like a renowned mathematician. And so he goes in there and he sees this. Of course, being a kid, he doesn't put anything together. But
he was a kid and allowed in this building?
Pardon?
He was a kid and allowed in this building?
Well, his father was a mathematician, and he went with him. Sure. Maybe they didn't think too much about a kid being there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And, you know, the guy isn't prone to making up stories. I don't see why he would tell me this.
Sure.
And he said his father and him went in there, and, I mean, like he didn't, like, hang out there and, you know, play on it.
Well, yeah, I understand.
See. But, so he goes in there, and his father was brought in, like, as a consultant from the government to, you know, do something, I guess.
Pardon? What did he say that he saw?
Well, he says he saw a spacecraft. He said it looked like a flying saucer, you know, and it was roped off, you know, had a barrier around it with ropes, and there was guards there, and it was a shiny metallic object, and, you know, being 4 years old, he doesn't remember too much. He doesn't remember any details of, you know, anything. But he does remember seeing that. And
he was 4 years old?
Yeah. Look, I guess if you were 4, you remembered seeing something like that.
I remember the day the Kennedy assassination happened. I mean, it'd be just like that. It'd be just an astounding happening.
Exactly. When he told me about this, then we started talking about UFOs, that I had seen one, and then he brought up that he had seen one at 4 years old, and he had actually got to, you know, like, walk up and take a look at it. And now that you bring up this Wright-Patterson thing with Hangar 18, this makes sense to me now, that this is in the Midwest. He says he went into a big old huge building, a big huge building, and there it was sitting there. And, his father goes in and he does his consulting work, and then they leave. And he was only there a short time, you know, maybe a couple days, a week or so, and then they leave. And that was all there is to it. There was, you know, his dad has never come and said anything to him.
Well, I'd sure like to hear his account from him, John. I mean, that's it's amazing. That's what we like to hear on this program. It's a great story.
I know. In fact, I wasn't really too sure when I called in where the place was or anything. He just relayed the story to me, and when this man came on before and said about this Hangar 18, all of a sudden it clicked in my mind. I said,
"Oh, that's great!
This might be the place." And you know, I've never really doubted that there were.
Hey, Bill. I mean, John. Look, I'm not doubting it. It's just I have to ask these questions. Like you said, you know, you've heard the story, and that's what this program's about. But I can't take everything that comes down the pike, and I'm just naturally curious.
Well, me too.
Sure.
I've always thought that.
And like you said, you prefaced your call by saying that.
Yeah. Well, I know. I wasn't really too sure, but after hearing this,
sure.
And I've known the guy for 30 years, and he told me this a long time ago. I mean, he told me this probably in the first 5 years I've met him, and I've known him for like 30 years.
Okay,
you know?
John, we're gonna take off here. Give us a call. Write to me. Call us after the show, ladies and gentlemen. We'll always take your calls after the show when you can talk to us.
Yeah.
We can get together at 667-7434. You can call now and talk to us now, and you can call us after the show. We're going to go to our Cosmic Concert Calendar and other special events with Nova. John, thank you very much for the call.
Gotcha.
All right, Nova, good afternoon.
Hi, how are you doing?
Just fine.
My name is Nova, and I'm with the Cosmic Connection announcements for this month. The show will be repeating Channel 21, Sunday, July 17th, 4:30 p.m., Monday, July 18th, twice at 1:30 and 7:30 a.m., and Thursday, July 21st at 11 p.m. The next new Cosmic Connection show will be live Tuesday, August 23rd on Channel 11 at 7 p.m. And we're having a special guest. Her name is Linda Moulton Howe, and she's the author of Alien Harvest. And she will be on the Cosmic Connection September 6th, live on Channel 11 at 7 p.m. The Northwest UFO Group, New Fog, will be meeting Sunday, July 17th at 2 p.m. at Portland State University, Kramer Hall, room number 53. Also, stay tuned for Art Bell's Dreamland, Sunday, July 17th, KEX 1190 AM radio, 7 p.m. to 10 p.m. And for the concert calendar at the Moosehead Cafe, the bands playing are Cool and Mr. Meaner, July 15th, 16th at 10 p.m., and Joe Rockhead, July 22nd and 23rd, and War Pigs, July 29th and 30th. And the Cosmic Connection just wants to thank everybody, you know, who has written to us in these past few weeks. And before we fade back to Cosmo, I just want to thank him for his first year anniversary on the show. So.
Great. Thank you,
thank
Nova.
You. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Outstanding job. Thank you today and again. And thank you, my friend, for coming today down in the studios, my friend. All right. That's Nova with her special reports there for the Cosmic Connection, the concert calendar. We'll see you at the Moosehead for those particular bands. Also, we'd like to bring up the New Fog, the Northwest UFO group that Nova brought up. That's the New Fog, Northwest UFO Group, the news. They have a letter. For more information, you may contact Charlene Elliott at area code 503-699-8367 or write to New Fog at 19363 Willamette Drive, number 226, Westland, Oregon, 97068. New Fog has meetings. I believe it's every third Sunday. They will be having a program that Nova brought up. You did bring that up, New Fog. That is July 17th at PSU, 2 o'clock, room 53, Kramer Hall. Dennis and I have discussed it. New Fog was in attendance out at the seminar with Schmidt, Don Schmidt, and Kevin Randall. And let's take another call at 667-7434. Welcome to the Cosmic Connection. Hello.
Hey, Mr. C.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, welcome.
Hey, this is the other Jay.
Hi, Jay.
I was calling to give you some information.
Have I spoken to you before, Jay?
Yeah.
I remember who you are.
You and I have met once before quite
That's
a while
right.
back.
That's right. You sent me a videotape of the Mars.
Right.
Outstanding package, Jay. I want to thank you very much. Keep in touch, my friend. It's been way too long.
Yeah, it has.
And I owe you some audio cassettes of Bob Lazar.
That's right. Yeah,
I still have them.
Well, I'll get in contact with you later on about that. But,
all right, call me after the program.
All right, I just want to congratulate you on your first year anniversary there.
Thank you, Jay. I believe you were with us from the beginning.
Yeah, that's right. Got
that
a lot of your
July
shows on
11th, tape. 1993.
That's right. I got some information on some of these moon pictures.
Excellent. Let's hear about it. First of all, let's tell everybody what you're talking about. What's this moon business?
Well, apparently the Mars mission headed by this gentleman, Richard Hoagland, used to be a science writer and correspondent for CBS News and CNN, has been studying, researching for the past year and a half or so on some anomalies up on the moon. Apparently some very, very large glass structures.
Right.
And they've went back in the NASA archives and got some of the old Apollo and Lunar Lander pictures and enhanced them. And they're available right now, a small number of them, on what's called American Online and CompuServe. For anybody out there that has computers signed up for any of these, they can now get them. Anybody else that has a is interested can start checking local bulletin boards around the city because they should be starting to filter down in on some of those. Some of them are pretty startling. I got one sitting here in front of me.
Is that right?
Of the it's called the Lunar Spire. And some of the other ones you really can't tell unless you really know what you're looking for. You have to read like some of the documentation that's down, you know, you get downloaded with it. But the one of the Lunar Spire, you can tell there's something there. There's something coming up right up from the lunar surface, something fairly large, about a mile and a half high, they say. So.
Well, I believe it's more than a mile and a half. I've been listening to the tapes from the last Dreamland all day today, just trying to get this in my brain, dealing with miles. Are we talking miles? Are we talking about structures here that are 30 miles high? Jay, are we dealing with structures here 30 miles high?
Yeah, some of them, Mr. Hoagland says, are up there 30, 40, 50 miles tall. So.
Okay, 45,000 feet, my director just said. Does that sound, I mean, we're talking glass structures that were could have possibly been hit by the Apollo 10 and Apollo 11 missions orbiting the moon.
Yeah, apparently some of the transcripts of some of those Apollo missions have some interesting statements on them that Hoagland has speculated about, that they're probably, you know, very, very close for hitting some of these things. They're so high up. So, but they're on, you know, people out there that aren't signed up for American Online or some of the other computer services, start checking the local bulletin boards, which are free, and
right.
It should start showing up. Also, Richard Hoagland is going to be on the Laura Lee Show tonight on KXL 750 AM.
Hey.
And it's going to be a replay. It's not going to be live, so they're going to replay it. And
okay.
That's going to be from 1 to 3 a.m. tonight.
All right, let's get that again now. That's 750?
KXL 750 a.m. between 1 a.m. and 3 a.m. tonight. And he's supposed to be on there, hopefully, for all 3 hours.
And that's Richard C. Hoagland on the Laura Lee Show.
Right.
Okay, and her name is Laura Lee?
Right.
You know, I've never heard this woman, not once, because our bell's on at the same time. And I don't channel surf on radio that much.
Yeah, it's both good shows though.
I've heard Laura Lee does some outstanding work. Miles is here. Hang on, Jay. Miles, what do you know about these structures on the moon?
I'm a little confused at this point in time. At one point, I've heard that they're 70 miles high. Another point in time, 30 miles high. And I think that they may be more around 3 miles high, as I've heard referenced to more
sure.
frequently. So
okay.
I'm under the impression at this point in time that they're...
Have you seen the photos, Miles? Go ahead, Miles.
Not yet.
You're under the impression of what?
That they're probably like large skyscrapers, which would be approximately in the mile range rather than the... multiple of 10 mile range at this point in time.
Thank you, Miles. Jay, I've heard this about these structures. Anything about what 30 mile high structures?
Yeah, Mr. Orban said there's quite a number of structures, and some of the more taller ones appear to be on the Earth side of the moon and up towards the northern region. Unfortunately, I don't have the exact names of the regions in front of me to name them off. But
okay. All right, now, Jay, you say you got photographs of this?
Yeah, I got about four of them sitting here right in front of me, and the majority of them here, just like I said, they really can't tell what's on them unless you really, you know, read the text and know what you're looking for. But there is one, and it's what's called the Lunar Spire. It's also been called the Shard. And this one, I think anybody can tell by looking at it. There is a large spiraling structure coming up from the lunar surface. And, you know, I've never seen any of the lunar photographs that's shown on ABC or CBS
right.
or anybody, anything like that.
Yeah, so. I wonder when this is going to come out over the networks.
Yeah, hopefully.
Hey, Jay, can you bring those pictures and any more pictures that you get between now and August 23rd, come down here and point out some of these anomalies for us?
Sure, I could do that or photograph or photocopy some of these and send them to you in the mail.
Well, I'd like to have you right here on the set.
It's a possibility. I'll talk to you about it after the show.
Very good. Very good, Jay. I want to thank you very much. We're going to take another call, Jay. Keep in touch, my friend. I think the audience out there would enjoy seeing these pictures just as soon as possible.
They're fabulous. They're just really outstanding.
And I'm just so sorry that I don't have these today to show the folks out there.
I do have a 1-800 number here real quick.
Pardon me?
I have a 1-800 number here because all this stuff's being put on videotape by the Mars mission. And if anybody wants information about that, they can call this 1-800 number if it's okay to give it out.
All right, let's do it.
It's 1-800-424-0031. That's 1-800-424-0031.
Okay, we'll talk about it after the show. I just want people out there to have a number on their computers that they can get a hold of. And I'd like to have them get a hold of Dennis's number. I don't have Dennis's number, and it's possible... one of the individuals in the control room would have Dennis's BBS number. Hi, welcome to the Cosmic Connection. We're going to take another call. Jay, thank you very much, my friend. Hi, welcome to the Cosmic Connection.
Hi, this is Marilyn from Portland.
Hello, Marilyn. Welcome.
Thank you. My question is, first I should say, in 63 or 64, my two sisters and I saw a flying saucer in the Salem area in South Salem.
Excellent.
And I was wondering if there was any other reports at that time frame.
What year is this?
63 or 64.
Uh-huh.
I think it was winter of either 63 or the first part of 64.
Well, that's what this program... We're trying to get the Oregon connection, you know, a little bit tighter because this place has just been a hotbed as of the last 2 years. There have been sightings. 63, 64, you know the McMinnville sighting was... that famous picture was shot here in McMinnville. We're just trying to put the information down, and just like when Hangar 18 came up, it jars somebody's memory. So, Marilyn, let's give a real quick date, time, who, what, when, and where on your sighting.
Okay, it was South Salem. My sister, who is a year older, woke me up in the middle of the night. She said she saw a red light in the sky. So I went into her room, and we watched the light, and what it did was it flashed back and forth across the sky at a very rapid rate, and then it would stop and it would move up and then down, and it continued doing that till it went to my side of the house again. So we went to my bedroom, woke my other sister up, looked out the window, and watched as the light came closer, and then we had this vacant lot that was alongside of our house, and we watched the light get brighter and brighter, and as it came down, what we observed looked like a cylinder-shaped object. And
it
had flashing
Neat.
Lights on the bottom, and it was almost like, you know, those old Thunderbirds that flash around, the lights kind of flash in a sporadic movement. But that's what it looked like, and it was just, the lights were flashing around on the bottom. And so I remember asking or yelling to my younger sister, run down and get my dad, and she ran down the hall to get him, and by the time he headed for the window, my older sister and I were still watching, it took... went straight up in the air and just shot off down. That would have been north, in the direction of north, and as my dad got to the window, it was just a red light in the sky again. Mm-hmm. So, and we were like 10, 12, and 13.
Sure.
So.
All right, Marilyn, we're going to take one more call, and then we're going to be out of here, all right? I want to thank you very much, Marilyn, for giving us a call. Please call again.
Okay.
And we'll probably go back to Nova for a final shot there, Mr. Camera 4. And next caller, please. Welcome to the Cosmic Connection.
Thank you. Happy anniversary.
Yeah, who's this?
This is Tim.
Tim?
Yes.
Tim, welcome. Hi, pal. Go ahead.
Yeah, all this talk about the structures on the moon, it kind of reminded me of a book I had read. I can't quite remember the title.
Bases on the Moon by, I believe, Fred Steckling?
Pardon?
Bases on the Moon?
No, this was written in 1956, and in the foreword, the author claimed that it really happened, and believe him or not.
Yeah.
But he evidently had been lived in the city, was taken to a shuttlecraft in the desert, and then up to some other ship, and hauled all around the moon.
I wonder if that's George Adamski or George Van Tassel out of Mojave, 29 Palms out there.
That sounds kind of
familiar. Very interesting. Something about flying saucers. There was a place out there called Big Rock Integratron, and the people would go out there and supposedly contact with aliens.
Yeah, well, this guy, yeah, they took him around like Dark Side of the Moon and showed him a lot of structures.
Yeah, it sure sounds like that same story.
Uh-huh.
Tim, thank you very much. I'm going to take one more call. I'm trying to press it and get everybody in on here, all right? Tim, call again. We'll see you August 23rd again, live, Channel 7, Channel 11 at 7 o'clock. Hi, welcome to the Cosmic Connection. You're next.
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Angela. I'm calling from Portland.
Your name's what?
Angela.
Okay, Angela. Can you make it quick, hon?
I will.
Thank
you. My question is about what you think of the theory of UFOs being a projection of the collective unconscious.
That's not... What do I think?
Probably not a very quick question, huh?
What do I think of UFOs?
Oh, do you hear what I'm saying? Can you hear me talking?
Yeah, sort of. There's a lot going on. You're asking me what I think of UFOs. I've seen 15.
Oh, I know. I'm asking if you think that they could be like a projection of the collective unconscious, like a mass hallucination, like people see Mary in a church. Thousands of people at once will see the Virgin Mary.
Uh-huh.
That it could be speaking to us about, that the sights that people see, like UFOs, could be speaking to us about an elevated consciousness that we might all experience at once.
Anything's possible, Angela, really. I've heard so many different aspects and beliefs in this. It's been quoted in the Bible. It's a never-ending story. I really don't know what to say.
It's probably hard to get into. Do you know anyone else other than Carl Jung that speaks about it?
I imagine you could contact the Oasis Center.
Okay.
All right, thank you. Angela, I'm sorry I couldn't answer your question.
That's all right.
Thank you. It's a good one. It's a good one. Thank you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take off out of here. Where did Nova go? We're going to be gone. Nova, what time are we? When are we coming back here again?
The new show.
Our next program.
The next program.
Live. All right, very good. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to want you to go out to the Oasis, the UFO. Fact or fiction or whatever facts or hoaxes of the UFO seminar this Saturday and Sunday at the Oasis Center. Also, want you to go out there and see Steve Johns at the Moosehead Cafe. Right? Right, Nova?
Right.
The Moosehead Cafe. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you very much for your participation in this program. Soren, Bad Karma, they've been taking July off. They're hard at work. Songs are being written. New albums are being put together. Those guys are working hard. I want to thank them. Give us a call at 667-7434 at the end of the show. Soren, thank you guys. Bad Karma, thank you guys. War Pigs, you guys are great. Nova, thank you very much, hon.
Thank you.
All to my entire crew, I want to thank them very much for 1 year's outstanding service and dedication to this program. Billy Goodman, my friend, thank you very much. Till next time, ladies and gentlemen, the Cosmic Connection. Thank you very much.
Thank you.